How's it going, everybody? Welcome to FoundFlix. On this Indie Explained, we're looking at the much-hyped and long-delayed Saint Maud, following a reclusive young nurse who adopts a pious path of Christian devotion after an unknown trauma. Now charged with a new dying patient, Maud comes to believe that she must save her soul from eternal damnation. You know, I have to admit, after so many delays and waiting, I couldn't help but be slightly disappointed when I finally got to see Saint Maud for myself. That is no fault of the movie, but entirely my own. The anticipation was too much for it to live up to, and it's less of a horror film and more of a character study. However, it's still an amazingly well-crafted film, with excellent performances that is beautifully shot in a very dreary kind of way that helps us get deep into the mind and feelings of Maud. Because that's really what is at the heart of the movie and its story. It's all about Maud. As events unfold and things go into a potentially supernatural direction, it becomes a situation of, is this truly happening, or is it evidence of Maud losing touch with reality? It becomes fairly obvious which way things lean, especially by the end, so what I became more interested in is the story behind Maud that is never really fully revealed. Although there are several clues throughout that reveal what sent her on her new pious path, so that is what we'll be focusing on more directly. Just who was Maud before her faith, what led her to it, and why, as this helps us to really understand Maud as a character along with the meaning behind her actions. So let's dive into Saint Maud, breaking down the story, including everything we learn about her, as well as if what she's experiencing is real or in her mind, and explaining the ending that puts everything into perspective. Panning down on some kind of hairy mass, there's a pool of blood on the floor, as well as streaks all over a shell-shocked looking Maud's face, seeing a body on a gurney, the blood continuing to drip. While we don't get too much info regarding this, it's certainly apparent that she accidentally killed her patient, which at least in some ways leads to her personal reinvention, as we come to learn. Sometime later, she boils some tomato soup, the creepiest looking soup I ever saw, and takes a seat in her quite modest apartment, and says a prayer. Dear God, watch over me as I embark on my next post. Gotta get up early. Understanding she's starting a new job. She continues her dialogue with God, asking forgiveness for her impatience, but that she hopes that he reveals his plan for her soon. Certain that she was saved for something greater than this. She walks through her sleepy seaside town, that actually looks kinda cool to me. She ascends a massive staircase, leading to an absolutely monstrous house at the top of the hill. A quite drastic contrast to Maud's own home. Another nurse answers the door, warning to keep her off the sauce. And Maud asks how the patient is, and she doesn't mince words, calling her a bit of a cunt. Oh, there you go. She settles in for her new gig, putting some clothes in the dresser, and of course hangs a crucifix on the wall. She goes to check in on her patient, Amanda, who has stage 4 lymphoma of the spinal cord. In her inner dialogue, telling him she'll most likely be seeing her soon. Amanda is a bit bristly, coldly ordering her to do some shopping, and when trying to help her in her wheelchair, she takes over, insisting that she's got it. Maud doesn't seem too bothered, humming to herself, bringing up that she looked up Amanda online, learning that she was a dancer, choreographer, and minor celebrity. She writes all of these accomplishments off ultimately, feeling that she has no time for creative types, finding them to be self-involved. The next morning, Maud leads Amanda through some physical therapy, pulling and tugging on her limbs. When bending over, Amanda notices her necklace and asks which saint it is. Mary Magdalene, Maud replies, her interest in Maud's religion something that she will become further attached to. She calls her prettier than the last one, Maud unsure how to respond to that, which is a bit awkward considering their positioning, holding her leg over her shoulder and everything. Maud digs around the bookshelves, finding a bit more relics of Amanda's past, including a few books that she has written and a collection of performance posters tucked behind a sheet. Maud appearing struck in a way by her dramatic pose. Hearing some ESG playing in Amanda's room, she asks how her wig looks, getting dolled up to meet a friend. Richard shows up, not really paying Maud any mind, and she leaves to go out on the town, thinking Amanda must be embarrassed of her. She would have been happy to just stay in her room. Dreamily chomping down on a burger, she thinks further on Amanda's situation, wondering how she ended up in this dump of a town, and it must be as bad for her as it is for me. She blankly clicks a lighter and gets a call asking her back to the house. She finds Amanda upset and drunk, Richard encouraging her to move back to London, her responding by throwing her drink at him. He apologizes, as she used to be able to handle her liquor, but as she says, things are different now. He asks if she's gonna be alright, her annoyed calling him an idiot. Take care of yourself, he says, planting a kiss, and see that they were watching an old performance of hers, then Amanda retches. It's almost as though she's trying to get back to her old life in some way, but she knows that that is no longer possible, something that is a huge struggle for her to accept, hence the aggravation towards Richard, reminding her of London and everything. Grabbing a glass of water, the light in the hall buzzes for a moment. Amanda asks her to stay, as she doesn't want to be alone. She asks how long she's been doing this. Just over a year. Prior, she worked at the local hospital. Well, why did she leave? Maud starts that she needed a change and trails off, resolving that it's what God wanted. When he came, everything changed. Certainly that opening accident is actually what caused her to leave the hospital, but she's not going to admit that. Amanda asks about Maud, and when she prays, does she actually believe that she hears his voice in return? Maud explains that it's like he's physically in me or around me. For example, when pleased, she feels him like a shiver or a pulsing. It's all warm and good. He's there. Amanda laments that since moving back, she's been mulling over her last moment of life and wondering what it will be like. And then what? Nothing? She sighs, pleading for Maud to tell her that she's wrong. Maud gets up and whispers in her ear, there's more, not just afterwards, he's everywhere. He sees you and won't let you fall. Amanda seems pleased with this answer, taking her hand and calling her my little savior. As Maud goes upstairs, the electricity crackles, the lights pulsing. She touches her head, a slight smile pursing her lips. She exhales sharply. Ooh, must be some of those feelings of him that she mentioned. It grows more intense, and she falls to the ground overwhelmed, touching her face, her eyes becoming bulging and distorted for a moment, looking up to Jesus on the wall. She now believes that she has found her grander purpose to help save Amanda's soul. Sure, mopping up after the disease is one thing, but bringing her to the light of God is so much more. Maud says that she feels his presence in the air, and is filled with more of his love than ever, more than enough to share with Amanda. She proceeds to pour out all of her liquor, and then gets another surge, breathing heavily and caressing her neck. Her mouth goes wide, but is interrupted by a woman, Carol, here to visit Amanda. She tries to turn her away, saying that it's too late for visitors, but she pushes past her, telling her that she's expecting me. Getting steamrolled as usual, Maud. She washes her face, frighteningly seeing some blood mixed with the water, and in the mirror sees she has quite a nosebleed, overhearing the women laughing in the other room. In the morning, she sees Carol through a crack in the door, a handful of cash. Interesting, a little pay-to-play action, huh? Well, I doubt Maud approves of that. The two sit down for some soup, but of course, gotta pray first. Amanda mimics her actions as she does so. Dear God, here is Amanda. Thank you for bringing us together and for this meal. And asks him to reach out to her as it did to her. Maud gasps, and she keeps inhaling sharply. Amanda says that she feels it too, and sighs just like Maud does, falling back in an almost state of ecstasy. She flashes back to them doing therapy, her hands all over her body. Amanda reaching out her hand, and she appears to climax, really seeming that Maud is developing some complicated feelings for her patient here, and in this case is most likely also jealous of Carol. In a brief, yet very important moment to understanding Maud's past, while lying in bed, we see that her stomach is covered in what appears to be postnatal stretch marks, and certainly losing a child or whatever happened here could be another aspect that led to her newfound faith. Amanda has a somewhat insulting present for her, a book all about artist William Blake, featuring many holy-looking paintings, and while religion did play a pivotal part in his works, it was mainly that of rejecting organized religion, which he claimed was an ugly distortion of what it truly is, directly flying in the face of Maud's whole thing, again seeming like Amanda's just kind of messing with her. Carol pops in, noticing Maud's immediate face of disapproval, as she pops a bottle of champagne. She instantly gets to work cleaning up the mess, and scoffs, "Don't let her drink too much," Carol assuring that it's mostly for her. Maud sneaks a peek through the door, hearing some more ESG, and sees Carol and her making out. Carol gets up, dancing around in the darkness, while Amanda seems to notice her spying and covers herself up. Maud still staring inquisitively. She obviously doesn't approve of any of this, literally waiting at the top of the stairs until Carol comes out of the room the next morning, running down as soon as she sees her and confronts her. She tells her to stop seeing Amanda, her thinking that she put her up to this, but confirms, no, it's just me. She has too much to do and can't fit her in her life. Carol spits that her patient's sex life is none of her concern. Maud pointing out the whole being given money thing, telling her again it's best to stay away. She gets a hard edge, telling Carol that she wouldn't care who she was, man, woman, or whatever, she would say the exact same. And then gets gravely serious. This is a matter of life and death, spiritual on another level. Carol tries to rein her back in, asking, do you hear yourself? You're her nurse. After pressing her further, Carol caves, telling her, fine, she'll do it. Whatever you say, Maud. She also tells her to not tell Amanda that it was her behind this, worried that she'll wind up looking bad as a result. Well, that's exactly what happens. She leaves, and Maud looks quite pleased with herself. Now just the two of them. She's happy, as Amanda's phone has been silent all day, saying that they don't need anyone else, and takes some water, drawing crosses on the walls in her room. Maud really is looking content, walking by the sea humming to herself, until the past comes crashing into her little bubble. A voice shouts out to her, calling her Katie, a young woman Joy stopping her and asking how she's been. Wait, who's Katie? Joy thought that she must have left town, since she hasn't seen her out and about lately. Ma telling her that she's in private care now. Joy is taken aback, like, you're still nursing? They know what happened, right? Yes, Maude says curtly. Before leaving, Joy gives her number, offering to meet up for drinks sometimes if she wants. Right, so we're getting more pieces of what happened in Maude's past, or really Katie, I guess, as Joy reacts with surprise that she's still nursing. The accident must have actually made it impossible for her to get any more work, hence changing her name to Maude and taking on her newly religious mindset. Maude and Amanda playfully bicker about her cheating at solitaire until her phone rings and Amanda asks for some privacy. She cheerily answers, "Oh, I didn't expect to hear from you." Her tone then suddenly changing, asking, "What? What do you mean? Why?" Maude looks anxious, waiting for water to boil, and comes in innocently with a cup of tea, suggesting they should go to the theater sometime. But a temperamental Amanda rebukes her, muttering that she just wants to go to bed. Well, sounds like that call with assumedly Carol did not go as she hoped. Watching TV at night, the whispering voices return, and she lifts the cover on the stove, thinking for a moment before jamming the back of her hand on it, sizzling the flesh. It seems that things are still okay between them after all, bringing her breakfast, as Amanda gabs away on the phone. She asks her to pick up some things for the party tonight, both exchanging smiles. But all is not well for Maude after all. Later, the party is in full swing, and she sees that Carol is there to her dismay, looking like Carol actually ended up tattling on her after all. Preparing her birthday cake, another lady, Heather, takes it and steals her thunder, Maude sulking in the corner while everyone sings for Amanda. She overhears her talking about her, saying that she's not sure if she's bigoted or just jealous, and goes on about how she tried to sneak behind her back to save her soul. Maude understandably wants to leave, but she stops her. "My savior," she seethes, "but you got a little carried away, didn't you?" and asks if she thinks she's indecent. "No, you're lost," Maude cries, and she just laughs in response. Maude is struggling, and again tries to leave. The other guests grab a napkin and fashion it into a nun bonnet, laughing, "My little saint." Man, these guys are pretty rude. Amanda grabs her hand, asking don't take anything she says seriously. She just wants her to loosen up and have some fun while you can. Clearly her attitude on the situation. Maude dismisses this, saying that she has more important things on her mind. Amanda glibly responding, "Oh yes, how could human frivolity ever compare to the Lord?" Maude loses it at the insult and smacks her good, getting another attack. Naturally, she's sacked because of this, the employer telling her that she should be thankful she's not pressing charges. She mentions word from Amanda expressing concern over her, asking if everything is all right. Maude looks away, saying she's fine, but I don't know about that. She returns to her dingy apartment, staring at the various Marys all around, all on her super shrine, which has earned a layer of dust in her absence. She prays in anguish. All she feels now is pain, gnawing, or burning. She says that she doesn't understand his plan. "If you were trying to teach me something, I can't see what it is." Her faith now wavering after everything, her unstableness is visually seen with upside down angles as she further expresses her disdain. She calls it all a waste. She was ready and open and alive, and this is her reward? Unemployable and unoccupied. Perhaps he is not as wise as I thought, or not paying enough attention. Either way, she feels spited by this outcome. She spirals further from her faith, and perhaps actually is falling back into her old behaviors. She picks out her burn scab, which is pretty gnarly, but stops herself when the crucifix falls on its own, and she sees Amanda has moved on to a new caregiver, seeing them at her spot by the sea. Later, looking quite glammed up compared to what we're used to, she visits a bar, again in complete opposition to her feelings before. She surveys potential suitors around the room, one guy giving her a glance back, and she goes right into giving him a handy in the bathroom. Whoa, okay, that was kind of surprising. As soon as he's done, she limply wipes her hand and immediately leaves. Just love him and leave him, Maude. She goes for another round, and looks to be trying to understand regular human behavior, focusing in on a group of friends chatting and laughing. She attempts to copy their laughter, but her face instantly retreats back into a hardened scowl. After downing a shot, she decides to take Joy up on her offer of getting drinks. She actually seems into it until Maude awkwardly tells her she thought it was weird when she suggested it. Thanks to this, Joy turns her down. Maude sheepishly apologizes and hangs up. Boy, it sure is tough acting like a human sometimes. Looking around the bar, staring at its various occupants, it's like their actions are all strange and foreign to her, and ultimately unappealing. It seems all too much, and a kind of whirlpool vortex appears in her drink, freaking her out, and she backs up up, seeing in the other's drinks they all have their own. She then bumps into a guy spilling his drink, chuckling, "Well, it looks like Yomi won," skipping right to them having sex. Her attempt at carnal pleasure is ruined by flashes from the accident. We see her attempting to resuscitate an older lady with a handheld oxygen mask, and then starts pressing on her chest. Horrifyingly, on one attempt, his chest appears to collapse inwards. So this is most likely what actually happened with the woman from the opening, and apparently this can actually happen, which is very, very disturbing. And by that same token, can also see just why Maude has been struggling so much. And here we also learn more about her past, as the guy says that he remembers her. She used to be out all the time a while back, and even hooked up with one of his mates, coyly calling her the lovely little nurse, eh? What this whole segment really illuminates to me is a fuller picture of what her life was like as Katie, which she is seemingly falling back into here. Heavy drinking, copping off with strangers and what have you, because it certainly all comes quite naturally to her here. It's not like she's very awkward about it, she just boom, right into bed with a stranger. Okay, sure, why not, I guess. This all could tie into that potential baby, as she could have easily gotten pregnant thanks to her sleeping around. As Joy says later too, her and the other nurses back then recognized that she was going off the deep end and didn't say anything, ultimately leading to the fatal accident that derailed her life completely. Her discussion with God at home appears to back this up, moaning that she changed everything and that she did what he told her. She pleads that she'll do anything, asking for his guidance. Her hand starts shaking and she throws up all over the table, while outside, fireworks starts popping up. Everything goes wonky. Maude falls to the ground. She weakly crawls a few feet and stops. Gasping deeply, she rolls over, choking and intensely convulses. Also worth mentioning that during a seizure, brain cells fire uncontrollably up to 4 times their normal rate, and can temporarily affect the way a person thinks, which potentially explains what's going on here. Her feet lift, followed by the rest of her body into the air, the fireworks continuing to burst behind her. Pretty damn good looking shot there, Glass. But I think rather than anything supernatural going on, this is the beginning of her starting to really succumb to all of her bubbling issues. Her believing this happened in her mind brought on by the seizure. Regardless of what's real or not, she appears relieved now, her opening her eyes and exhales, and gets her life back on track, cleaning her place up with a new demeanor of determination. She took that moment as a sign from God, a revelation, just in the nick of time, shaming herself for giving up on her faith so easily, and now really commits herself to her faith in a quite painful way. She cuts out pictures of Mary, inserting thumbtacks through them, and placing one in each of the bottom of her sneakers. She stares for strength to the shrine, and closes her eyes, shoving her feet into crunching and screams of agony. Out in the street, she's taking labored steps, shuddering to herself quietly, certainly in pain with every movement, but fighting through it for the Lord. She's still hung up on Amanda, looking through a telescope, focusing on her house out on the hill. She then does a search for her, and finds a clip of her falling, but staring straight at the camera unsettles Maude, closing her computer. She thinks to herself, "Amanda, Amanda, you called out to me," going through pictures of her Blake book and cuts some out, also tacking up her signature on her shrine. Then no doubt purposefully visits the seaside where she just happens to run into Amanda's new nurse. Oh, convenient! She prods her a bit about her job, buttering up that she has so much respect for anyone in the medical profession, deeming it the most important thing you can do with your life. Well, almost. Saving souls is way better. Come on. Sure, it's worthy work, but no time for a personal life, right? Esther disagrees. She's got her own life, like, you know, choir practice and stuff. So that's something. And as suspected, it appears Maude is asking these questions to find out what is wrong with her, and even thinks this to herself. She continues beating herself up, wondering if she's an idiot like Esther was to her, and that maybe indeed Amanda thought of her that way the whole time. Yeah. Wide awake in bed, a beetle scurries around the darkness. She looks over to her shrine, and a strange kind of wave of energy passes over it, where it appears that God finally speaks back. Hearing a deep voice speaking in Welsh, he says, "Hello, my child. The hour draws near. Soon you will join the great embrace. You've known for some time this world is just a game. You could feel there was something more." He says he's impressed with how far she's come and that he's proud. She hears something rustle, seeing it's a painting from the book, which from what I can see appears to be some kind of Phoenix Rising scenario. He lays it all out for her. Take on this one last test, and then they can truly be together. She asks, "How will I know what to do?" "You always have known," it offers, staring intently at the picture. This is what Maude has been hoping for throughout her entire journey of faith, and now it's finally happened. Hallelujah, right? I'm still not so sure. It really feels that it's more like another side of Maude actually speaking to herself, essentially representing her suffering a mental break. And also this supposed voice of God is actually Maude's own voice pitch shifted down, really in a way talking to herself, and indeed convincing herself of what she needs to do next. And it's in desperation of her situation that she's reached this point. After some rest, she fashions a sheet into a ceremonial robe and dons a rosary. She cleanses herself in a sink full of acetone and hydrogen peroxide. Well, that will definitely clean you up good. She's shocked back to reality by a knock at the door, and it's Joy, asking to come in. And when stepping in the room, gives a half-hearted, this is nice, about the abode. She apologizes about the other night, asking her about her work. Maude simply stands there silently. She tries to comfort her that what happened before wasn't her fault, and it's here that she admits they all knew that she was struggling, but failed to step in time. Maude just keeps staring off in a daze, not even uttering a word. Joy's voice fades away as the clouds start to swirl above, resembling the same kind of vortex she saw in her beer. Only now does she turn back and walk over to Joy. She gives her a kiss on the cheek. May the Lord bless you and keep you, she says. And after that sight, she is certain of her fate and the next steps of her plan. She goes on that Joy was right. She was lost, but now I'm transformed and everyone soon will see. A bit confused, Joy stammers, right, well, that's good. Maude smiles, thanking her for coming out and ushers her away. Happy that things are looking up for her. Oh yeah, we're going big time, Joy, taking a ride on the vortex in the sky. She puts on her ceremonial sheet and heads out into the night, naturally to Amanda's. She waits outside, hearing more whispers as the other nurse leaves and sneaks in after. She finds Amanda in bed, staring her down as she approaches. She places a hand on her face and Amanda takes it, tenderly bringing her closer. She croaks that she is sorry for being so unkind to her, admitting that she made her think of things that she didn't want to. Life, death, the afterlife, and all that junk. As we know, her time is growing short. Maude states, it's all right. The Lord forgives that which is said in anger, but he knows her heart. The Lord, she scoffs. Yep, he sent me to you and forgives everything. Amanda pulls away, shrieking no more nonsense to Maude's shock. She sighs, you must be the loneliest girl I've ever seen. Maude is stone-faced. I'm here, Amanda. I'm not alone and neither are you. Again, trying to place some holy drops on her head. She pushes her away, telling her to snap out of it. He isn't real. You must know that. Poor Maude remembers that whole thing with Amanda feeling it too, but she finally divulges that she was just making the whole thing up, blaming the loneliness that she feels from the inevitable crawl to death, and reiterates that there is nothing beyond our world, and nothing she does matters, causing Maude to snap. Amanda cackles. That was easy. Her face distorts wildly, shocking Maude. Devil, she cries. Amanda launches her into a mirror, now speaking in a low, demonic voice. You came back here because you're alone. If you were a true believer, he would have been enough. But it's clear now that she's as weak as her faith. Since this whole concept is what Maude has been struggling with the entire journey, this sends her beyond the limit, grabbing a pair of scissors and viciously stabbing Amanda in the neck until she gurgles and croaks. Well, I guess you get to find out about the afterlife sooner than you thought, Amanda. Thanks, Maude, for saving my soul, I guess, I think. No, not really. This was more personal to Maude than even about God, really, because she obviously had kind of a thing for Amanda and was jealous and all that, along with her actively spitting in the face of her faith in organized religion. This becomes what Amanda represents to Maude. Calling her faith into question again is what caused her to turn into her devil form, and in Maude's eyes required an instant kill. Outside, blood splattered all over her. Maude appears elated and actually is kind of floating above the ground. Back home, she scrubs up and grabs a fresh sheet. To her delight, she appears to have angelic wings now, thanks to her vanquishing the devil Amanda and fulfilling the final steps as God asked. She walks down to the beach, quiet and purposeful. She comes to the edge of the water. There's a distant rumbling, and the swirling vortex reemerges in the clouds, beckoning her to the heavens. She starts softly singing to herself, pulling out her bottle of acetone, highly flammable, obviously. She douses it all over her head, nearby pedestrians starting to take notice. Someone yelling to stop her. Yeah, well, go do it instead of standing there. She clicks her lighter that has never actually worked before, her breath shaking, everyone entranced and watching. She mumbles glory to God in Welsh, just as the voice in her apartment spoke, and for the first time at least that we've seen, the lighter sparks to life. Maude's body is enveloped in a holy light. Her wings return, everyone watching falling to their knees. She cries in ecstasy, and for a brief moment we're all like, well, man, I don't know, maybe it wasn't so crazy after all. That was pretty impressive. But then we smash cut to reality, her just a confused lost girl engulfed in flames on the beach, screaming as she's toasted and alive. Well, at least in her mind, she achieved her grander purpose, but the reality is that this was the final step of her mind completely breaking after suffering so much. Kind of a bummer, really. Well, that wraps it up for this Innie Explained for Saint Maud. While I definitely could have used some more scares in there, I did still admire much of Glass's debut, in particular the lead performance from Clark, along with its quite dreary atmosphere. I'll be curious to see what Glass does next, as she will no doubt continue to grow and mature as an artist, which is quite impressive considering this is her debut here. And don't forget, before we go, you can send me requests for any movies or TV shows you'd like to see me explain by sending them my way on any of my social media accounts at FoundFlix. What did you guys think of Saint Maud and its ending? Do you believe that it was actually real, or all just in Maud's broken mind? Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and follow. Thanks for watching FoundFlix. See you next time.